Good morning. It's so good to see you. I miss you guys. It's great to be back. If you have your Bible, please turn to 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3. Last Sunday, I was up at Bentry Frisco at Newman Elementary School in North Frisco. We're launching September 13th up there. Many of you know that because you're involved in that whole process. Last week, we did, for the first time, we got the school set up as a church. We brought the trucks in and we set it all up, and the transformation was truly remarkable. It was really stunning. Tons of volunteers getting all, figuring out where they're going to be serving and all that kind of stuff. It was a really exciting day. The folks are back up there again, so I want to say hi to our Bentry Frisco folks up in Frisco. I think they're watching this service and they're getting a feel for all the equipment and stuff. And it's exciting because about 300 of us and you have already signed up to volunteer to serve up there on Sundays, which means 300 folks are leaving here who have been volunteering and serving, which makes you going out into the lobby even more important. And one of the beautiful things about the multi-site concept is it gives so many more people opportunities to serve. And we know that spiritual growth seems to take off when led by the Spirit, you step into service. And so we want that for all of you. So please take advantage of that after the service today. Let's pray before we dive into God's Word together. Lord, thank you for this day. It's yours. You created it. Thank you for the breath of life. Thank you for allowing us all to wake up today and to be here. None of us by accident, to be listening. None of us listening by accident. You have something for each of us, and that only happens if your Spirit does the talking. So I surrender myself. Holy Spirit, speak through me. If anything I'm planning on saying that you don't want to say, just remove it. If you want to go a different direction, I'm available. Just tell us what you want us to hear, and we will listen. Lord Jesus, transform us. Change our attitudes where they need to be changed. Do your work in this time, I pray, in your precious name. Amen. I brought a HVAC filter up. You guys have these in your home, right? You do know you need to change these out every once in a while, right? This is a public service announcement. This is a good time of the year to make sure you're changing out your HVAC filters. When they are used correctly, they filter out a lot of the stuff in the air, so that a lot of it gets caught. If you haven't changed yours for a while, when you pull it out, it's black and messed up. We all have other filters, not just our HVAC filters. We have filters that we walk around with in our life right about here. They're filters through which we see the world. I'm going to ask you to drop your filters this morning. Just go like this. Put them on the ground, right there, right by your feet. You're like, well, Pete, what kind of filters are you talking about? Well, the filters that you use through which you see our culture and all the stuff that's happening in our culture. There's a lot of stuff happening in our culture. Have you noticed the stuff happening in our culture? Lots of stuff happening in our culture. Today is the one-year anniversary of the beginning of the mess in Ferguson. Lots happened in a year. A lot's happened as far as race relations are concerned and the violence that ensued after that. There's been rulings in the Supreme Court on the Affordable Care Act. Lots of conversation about that. There's been a move to remove the Confederate flag from some state houses in the South. That conversation's not happening in the North for obvious reasons, but it is down here in the South. The SCOTUS ruling on marriage equality took a lot of people by surprise a few weeks ago. Seeing the White House resplendent in rainbow colors was something some of us, or many of us, thought would probably never happen, but it did. More recently, some clandestine videos revealed the repulsive underbelly of an already repugnant industry. And we have found ourselves thinking, what in the world is going on? And as all this stuff happens, all of us see these things through our filters, which means we only allow certain things to get through because of our filters. So the filters, some of the filters I want you to drop today. I want you to drop your conservative or liberal filter. I want you to drop your Republican, Democrat, or Libertarian filter. I want you to drop your CNN, MSNBC, or Fox News filter. I want you to drop your red, yellow, black, and white, I am sure I'm always right filter. Just throw that one right down there on the ground as well. My hope is that you will leave your filter on the ground while I'm talking, because as believers in Jesus Christ, we have a much better filter. This is our filter. This is our filter by which we see culture. And friends, it's hard to read like this. So let's drop our filters and see what this has to say. Those things I just listed, the Ferguson, the Affordable Care Act, the removal of the Confederate flag, the SCOTUS ruling on marriage equality, the videos with Planned Parenthood, that this series that I'm starting today has nothing to do with any of that and everything to do with all of that. In other words, I'm not going to talk specifically about all those things. I'm going to talk about how we as a body of believers, how we as believers in Jesus Christ live and interact and engage this messed up culture we live in. How do we do it? In 1996, D.A. Carson wrote this book. It's called The Gagging of God. I have it on my shelves. I think six people have read this book from cover to cover. I am not one of them. I've read a good chunk of it. It's a fascinating book. The reason it's fascinating is because it's subtitled Christianity Confronts Pluralism. And he started talking about postmodernity. He talked about pluralism and the pluralistic culture we live in. And he started predicting exactly what is happening now in 1996. I thought it was fascinating. His dedication is to Tiffany and Nicholas. I'm assuming grandchildren. I don't know that for a fact. This one is for Tiffany and Nicholas, not because they can as yet understand much of it, but because in a few years, they will need it. Prophetic. He described where we're living in 1996. Some people were not shocked by this. Others, many of us, are kind of like the surfer in Australia. Did you see this video? You know the guy who was in the surfing competition and he got attacked by a shark? Did you see the picture right before the shark hit him? I know many of you have seen the picture. He's just sitting there enjoying the sun on his face, looking for the next wave, completely oblivious. And then they're like 3 feet behind him, this big dorsal fin coming. You're like, ah! The church. That's us. We're sitting, enjoying the warm sun on our face, looking forward to the next wave of whatever it happens to be, completely oblivious to the fact that we live in shark-infested waters. And we're surrounded. And you know what he did right when the shark attacked him? He did what we're taught to do. Were you taught to do this when you were a kid? If a shark attacks you, what are you supposed to do? Punch him in the nose. Boom. That's what he did. He started punching him in the nose, which is what we do when we feel like we're attacked. We come out punching because we're shocked and we're scared and we don't know what else to do. And friends, to come out punching will not help us in our mission, which is to find ourselves deeply entrenched in the lives of really hurting lost people so that we can point them to the truth. God's love and grace in Jesus. So even though very few of us saw this coming, we find ourselves in the midst of it, finding ourselves having conversations today that literally 365 days ago we weren't even having. We're discovering fans or friends or family members who are coming out of the closet. We're being invited to gay weddings and we don't know what to do. We're engaging in Facebook discussions on really intimate issues. And those discussions quickly deteriorate, don't they? We're having dinner with our 20-something children and we have a conversation about something, and we assumed their values were just totally aligned with ours. And here we are in the middle of this conversation going, whoa, did we not tell them? Well, we told them, but they're hearing other things, and they're being influenced, and that's a little scary. And we're confronted with decisions. What do I do? What do I not do? Do I get involved? Do I write or call my representative? Do I not write or call my representative? Do I keep paying my taxes? Do I buy a gun? What do I, all these things we're thinking about that literally a few years ago, we were just thinking about our kids' sports teams. Life is changing. How do we live in this messed up world? I'm going to spend 5 weeks talking about how we do it, next 5 weeks. And it's all summarized in two words. If you write anything down, write this down. Tender boldness. Tender boldness. What's fascinating when you're reading the scriptures is you need to realize that the New Testament scriptures were written to a church that lived in a hostile culture, a hostile environment. As our culture becomes more and more hostile, this is one of the upsides. We will be able to understand the Bible much better because the Bible is written to a group of people living in a hostile culture. We've been living on the beach. So it's been hard to understand certain portions of Scripture. We read certain portions of Scripture about persecution and we're just like, I just don't have a category. Well, you're about to. It'll be easier to understand Scripture. That's one of the upsides of the next few days, next few years, next few decades. But this text is written to a body of believers in a very hostile environment. And when you look at the general themes of the biblical writers, when talking about how to engage a contemporary culture, tenderness and boldness just come through over and over and over and over again. Couple examples. In 2 Corinthians 3:12, and we're going to spend a lot of time in 2 Corinthians in this series, the Apostle Paul says, since we have such a hope, we are very bold. And the hope he talked about was the hope of the new covenant. We'll talk all about that in the next couple of weeks. We're very bold, he said. The word bold is parousia. It means to have confidence, to be bold, to stand plainly and openly, to speak clearly what we believe. We're bold. We don't back off. We speak the truth. So in Acts chapter 4, verse 13, this word is found. It's after Peter and John have been kind of going nose to nose with the religious leaders of the day. Very boldly. And it says, when they saw the courage or the boldness of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. You see, you don't have to go to seminary to be bold. You just have to spend a little time with Jesus to be bold. And us unschooled, ordinary people can stand with confidence because we know Jesus and we know who he is. Very end of the book of Acts says, after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. This was the modus operandi of the early church. They boldly communicated God's truth. Didn't back down at all. Boldness, tenderness, constant theme for the church, engaging the culture. Turn to Colossians chapter 4. I know I asked you to turn to 1 Peter. Put a piece of paper in there. Turn to Colossians chapter 4, verse 4. Colossians 4, 4. Apostle Paul is asking for prayer. And he said, pray that I may proclaim it clearly. It, if you look at the preceding context, is the mystery of the gospel, the beautiful truth of Christ and his finished work, the beautiful truth of Christ and his indwelling presence, the beautiful truth of Christ and his unity in the body, bringing us all together for mission and for everything else that he wants to do through us. That's all the mystery. And he said, pray that I would proclaim it as I should, clearly. Pray for boldness for me. Then he speaks to us, believers, and he says, be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. There will be many. Let your conversation always be full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Please notice how to answer everyone, not what to answer to everyone. Sometimes we get the idea that if we can just get the answers right, then we can just go for it. He's talking here about the manner in which we respond to people. Certainly that includes knowing what to say, but it's also talking about the tone with which we say it. And he says, always full of grace, seasoned with salt. It doesn't say always full of saltiness, seasoned with a little grace. Well, sometimes we think that, especially if we're predisposed to be bold. Like, you know, I'm going to let them have it and I'll sprinkle a little grace in there. No. Always, listen, full of grace. Seasoned with salt. That little idiom, seasoned with salt, means in an appropriate and proper manner, in a respectful way. Tenderness, graciousness, tender boldness. I had a conversation with Dr. Daryl Bach a few weeks ago. Daryl's a part of our body here, but he's also the executive director for cultural engagement at the Howard Hendricks Center for Christian Leadership and Cultural Engagement at Dallas Seminary. And he's a scholar, a New Testament scholar who has a passion for the church. And we were talking about how do we lead the church into this new season we're in. And he used an interesting phrase. He says, we just need everyone to realize that we are now the church in exile. We're now the church in exile. We live in Babylon. We're the church in Babylon. And the way we live is going to look different than the way it's been in the past. And he said to me, Pete, he said, we've got to get across that tone matters. Tone matters. See, we need to change our tone or we will lose our voice. Can I say that again? We need to change our tone or we will lose our voice. Because you see, if we're speaking in a tone that makes them not listen, we may as well not be speaking. But if we are using a tone that draws in, then we can share truth with people who desperately need to hear it. Tender boldness. The most straightforward text in all of the New Testament, I believe, on this specific topic is found in 1 Peter chapter 3. That's why I asked you to turn there. Let's study it a little bit together. 1 Peter chapter 3, starting in verse 8. Peter was speaking specifically to a persecuted people. Now, the people that Peter wrote to were suffering for saying yes to Jesus in ways that we have not yet begun to experience. And so he's speaking specifically into living in a hostile culture. And just walk through the text with me. Finally, all of you, be like-minded. He's speaking to believers or live in harmony. Be sympathetic, love one another, be compassionate or tender-hearted, and humble. The word humbly there means literally friendly of mind. To be friendly. You know what it means to be friendly? We teach our kids how to be friendly. He's saying in any interaction that you're having, come at it from a friendly place. Treat them like friends, whoever you're talking to, and whatever the topic might happen to be. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult. I think Peter was prophetically looking forward to Facebook. Because you know what happens in Facebook? Someone posts something that insults someone, and then in the comments they insult back, and the insulting cycle begins. And if you spend enough time in there, you'll just be completely depressed. Instead of replacing insult with insult, on the contrary, repay evil with blessing. Repay evil with blessing. When you're persecuted, when you're insulted, bless them. In secular Greek, the word bless there simply means to speak kindly of someone, but the biblical authors took that word and embedded deeper meaning in it, and it means to be gracious towards someone, like God graciously blesses us to take the first step to initiate investing in someone's life in such a way that their life is better because you invested in them, to bless them. This is how believers respond to people who insult them, and some of you are thinking, that's whacked. I know, it's really different. It's completely different. It's the way the church is different. One of the many ways that we are different. So do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing. Because to do this, you were called so that you may inherit a blessing. That doesn't mean that you do this so you get blessed. It means in your calling, blessing was a part of your calling. And because he has blessed you by his grace, you are now a conduit of blessing to others. And remember, he blessed us when we were still yet enemies. Christ died for us. This, he says, is how we treat one another. For, verse 10, now he's going to quote Psalm 34, whoever would love life and see good days must keep their tongue from evil and their lips from deceitful speech. They must turn from evil and do good. They must seek peace and pursue it. Underline those words, seek peace and pursue it. Whenever we're engaged in the culture, we are to seek peace and pursue it. Do you hear the plea for tenderness and graciousness all the way through this text? We are peace seekers in a war of words. That's who we are. We're peace seekers in a war of words. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. That's good news. Woohoo! The righteous, remember, the New Testament teachers are those who have said yes to Jesus, and he has transformed them, made us righteous, and coming to indwell us. That's who he's talking about here. The eyes of the Lord are on us, and his ears are attentive to their prayer. So he's watching us, and he's listening to us. He's engaged with us. Woo! This is good news. But, it says, the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil. The face of the Lord is against them means that they will not ultimately prosper. I know a lot of times it seems like they're prospering right now. It means ultimately they will not prosper. Peter talks a lot about the ultimate judgment where people stand before Jesus. And if you are in Christ, you get warmly welcomed into glory forever. If you are not in Christ, you have a conversation with Jesus about the way you lived your life. It's going to happen. And it says in this text, those who do evil, the face of the Lord is against them. What a terrifying thought. I encourage you to put your filter down. I put mine down too. And I ask myself the question, okay, what does the scripture say about life and about people? About the shedding of innocent blood. And scripture is categorically clear from the beginning of Genesis through the end of Revelation. Life is precious. Life is a gift from God. He decides when it starts. He decides when it ends. You read through the book of Proverbs over and over and over again. It's very clear. The shedding of innocent blood is reprehensible in God's eyes. The book of Psalms, it talks about the fact that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, that we are God's masterpiece even while we are in the womb of our mothers. Scripture is clear that life is precious, and to end innocent life is evil. So, one who ends the innocent life of a child in utero is doing something evil. And then to profit off that over and above it is heaping evil on top of evil. And we look at it and we feel sick and we wonder, what's this world coming to? And the answer is, this world is coming to each one of those people one day standing before Jesus, and the bravado they are now demonstrating will be far gone, I promise you. Because the face of the Lord is set against those who do evil. That does not mean that grace is not available to those folks. If they bow their knee to Jesus today, their sins, just like yours and mine, completely erased. New creation in Christ, living forever in glory with him. But if they remain in their evil place doing evil things, his face will be set against. This is biblical truth. No filter here, it's just what the Bible teaches. And so we stand confidently in what we know to be true. And in boldness we speak it. With tenderness and graciousness. You say, Pete, this sounds really hard. Yeah, That's why we need Jesus for this. But we have him. So let's keep reading, because we're not quite done yet. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? In other words, if you treat people with consistent graciousness, if when they insult you, all you do is bless them back, over time, one of two things is going to happen. Either they're going to start leaving you alone, or they'll continue, and at the end, we see they'll be ashamed. We'll see that in just a minute. But even if you are to suffer, even if you should suffer for what is right or for righteousness' sake, please note, those of us who are suffering because we're jerks online, that's not what this text is talking about. Those of us who are cyber bullies, that's not what this text is talking about. This text is talking about people who are walking in grace and lovingly pointing people to truth and being persecuted for that. If that is happening to you, but even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. You are sharing in the persecution that Christ himself experienced. Matthew 5 teaches us, blessed are those who are persecuted for my name's sake. There is a joy, a rest, and a peace in knowing that you've been walking Jesus and you're getting beat up for it anyway. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. Isn't this a practical passage of scripture for where we are in our present day? It's incredible how practical it is. Don't be afraid. Don't fear their threats. Don't be frightened. Instead of that, verse 15, but in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Set him above all human authority and all human voices and honor him and revere him and obey him. Listen to him. Always be prepared to give an answer. The word give an answer is apologia, from which we get our word apologetics. It means to give reasons and rationale for what we believe. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give a reason for the hope that you have. You see, what's going to happen is people are going to be observing you, receiving insults, and responding with blessing and grace. And over time, they're going to be like, I don't get it. What gives? I mean, what is your deal? That guy's just so mean to you, and you're so kind. What's going on? And you are prepared to give a reason for the hope and the peace and the rest and the joy that you experience. We need to be prepared. We need to be willing to speak it. We need to know why we believe what we believe. And we need to do it in boldness. But, he says, listen, do this with gentleness or meekness. Not weakness, meekness. My dad taught me as a little boy that meekness and weakness are very different. Meekness is like a huge, beautiful war stallion under bridle. Enormous power and strength and dexterity and fluidity, but controlled by someone else so that it can serve the common good. We are in Christ strong, and under Christ we are controlled by someone else for the common good. We are not weak, my friends. We are gentle and meek. And it says in the text, respectful. We respect people, we honor people. Every single conversation we have, we honor and respect the other person, which means we seek to understand before being understood. It means we honor their position even if we disagree with it. It means we speak well of them even after the conversation, telling someone else about how it went. Always with tenderness and respect. Keeping a clear conscience in verse 16. So that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. Just keep blessing them. One day they'll be like, what am I doing? What am I doing to these poor people? Look, he says, against your good behavior in Christ. Just want to point this out. In Christ is one of Paul's favorite phrases. We think he probably coined it. He uses it 164 times. And no one before him used that specific phrase, but then authors after him did. So we think it was kind of Paul's catchphrase. And it reminds us that any good conduct, any behavior that we're seeing here is born out of our union with Jesus. It's all about the indwelling Christ doing this in us and through us. That as we continue to trust him, and he does this, over time, those who slander us will be ashamed. You might not see it anytime soon, but it's coming, it's promised. Just bank on it. Verse 17, for it is better If it is God's will to suffer for doing good, then for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. We'll talk a little bit more about suffering under persecution in the weeks to come. That being said, this is a beautiful reminder to us. This is a filter to us for how to interact with our culture. And the simple response is tender boldness. Tender boldness. So when we think about applying this, personalities come into play. Yes, your personality comes into play. Some of you would lean towards boldness over tenderness. Some of you are more tender than bold. In fact, raise your hand if you're more bold than tender. Come on, get your hands up nice and high. Let's see you. Oh, look at our bold folks. We need you. We love you. Raise your hand if you're more tender than bold. Tender folks, oh, thank you. You love us. We need you. Thank you. You're so good. Fact of the matter is, what we need is we need to be a body of believers characterized by tender boldness. If you are predisposed to be bold, then you're going to need to grow in tenderness. If you are predisposed to be tender, you're going to need to grow in boldness. If you're more prone to tenderness, the thought of boldness is terrifying, isn't it? And if you're more prone to boldness, the need for tenderness is just annoying. It's like, what's the point? Come on, let's just do this. Get this done. My dad, I was with my dad this weekend. We were doing some teaching. He told a story I'd never heard before. He grew up in Milham, a mining town in northern England, and sometimes there were accidents in the mine and people died. That used to happen a lot in those mines. And one day, a gentleman died down in the mine, and so they had to draw straws for who was going to go and tell his wife that he had died, and some poor guy lost. And so he goes, and he's looking for the address. He'd never even met this family before. And he knocked on the door, and the woman answers, and he says, "Are you Jim's wife?" She said, "Yes, I am." He said, "Well, you're not anymore. You're now Jim's widow." Turned and walked away. Okay, so there's some boldness there. I mean, that's bold. Not a whole lot of tenderness involved. What he said was completely true. She was no longer his wife, she was his widow. It was factually accurate and bold and to the point. There was no room for misunderstanding. But that's not everything. There's a tenderness that's absolutely necessary. For those of us who are bold, we need to grow in tenderness. For those of us who are tender, we need to grow in boldness. So maybe you've had a conversation with someone that you know that has taken a huge risk and has shared with you that they are struggling with same-sex attraction. They're believers. They've read the text. They have a feel for what God wants for them. And they're struggling and they haven't told anyone and they've finally decided to take a risk and they've told you. And because you're a tender person and you're loving, you embrace them and you weep and you cry and you say, "I'm going to pray with you," and you send them on their way. And you've helped a little bit, but they're still looking for direction. They're looking for hope. They're looking for help. And because you've lacked boldness, you haven't pointed them in a direction. And we need to grow in boldness. And we need to grow in tenderness. And we need to be tenderly bold or bold tender people as Christ expresses himself through us. The only way we can have a voice in our culture, this is the summary of my message. The only way we can have a voice in our culture is to say something that helps is by speaking with tender boldness. Tenderness ensures we have a voice. Tone matters. Boldness allows us to say something that actually helps. Truth helps. If you are a tender person, generally speaking, I'm going to encourage you over the next 4 or 5 weeks, Lord Jesus, enable me to grow in boldness. Show me what that looks like. Show me how to do it. Do it in me and through me. If you are a bold person, lighten up. And over the next few weeks, pray that God would show you what it looks like to grow in tenderness. I think if we start to realize that this is what he's calling us to do, then we'll start to figure out how to tackle all of these issues that we're grappling with in our culture, and there's so many of them. But if we know that in every single case we need to be boldly tender or tender bold people, and if we know which way we lean on one side or the other given the specific issue, then we know where we need to learn and grow as we engage. For example, as I have been learning over the last 2 or 3 years, because this issue of same-sex attraction and things has become such a big topic in our culture, 10 years ago I didn't think much about it at all. Now we're thinking about it all the time. I've learned a lot. I've read a lot. I've listened a lot. And on that specific issue, I would probably lean a little bit towards boldness. And I would want people to know what Scripture has to say about that behavior. And so recognizing this, I said, all right, Lord, I need to grow in some tenderness. And he led me to a book that I read this summer called Washed and Waiting by Wesley Hill. It's an absolutely beautiful book. Wesley, as a young man, grew up in a great evangelical home, gave his life to Christ as a young boy, and as long as he can remember, has been attracted to boys and not girls. Has been praying for God to change it, and God to date has not. And he starts telling stories about how he desperately tried to be different. One in particular, he's a young adult, he's with some of his Christian friends, he hasn't told them the struggle he's having internally, and so he's battling with that by himself, and it's hard. And they're at a wedding, and all the couples get up to dance, and it's kind of awkward. He's kind of sitting there, he's there alone, and there's a young woman who's kind of sitting there, she's there alone, and so one of his friends says, hey, you guys, why don't you dance together? Okay, come on. So up they go, and he said, she's absolutely gorgeous, drop-dead beautiful, wearing a lovely dress. He's got his hand in the small of her back, and he's holding her hand, and they're dancing slowly, and their bodies are close together, and his cheek is near her cheek. And the whole time he had his eye on a guy across the dance floor. And he's thinking, if this isn't the moment, when will it ever happen? And as I'm reading this story, I'm, for the first time in my life, I'm putting myself in his shoes, asking myself, what does this feel like? And my heart started to be tenderized. Wesley is living a celibate life, because he has read Scripture and he's realized that to act on those inclinations would be a sinful choice. And his description of what it's like as a young believer to live this way is one that if you struggle with tenderness in this issue, you need to read. Some of you are saying, I don't struggle with tenderness on that issue at all. Well, maybe Kevin DeYoung's book entitled What Does the Bible Really Say About Homosexuality would be a good book for you to read so you can learn to grow in boldness. We just got to figure out where do we need to grow, and then we've got to be available for the Lord to teach us. So I told you to drop your filters. Go ahead and pick them back up. Go ahead, everyone bend down and pick up your filter. Okay, and I want you to do this with your hands. Put it up there in front of your eyes like this. Okay, you all got up in front of your eyes like this. And here's what I want you to do. Did you see that? Let me do it again. Some filters are appropriate. What comes out of our mouth or what happens in our brain doesn't always have to come out of our mouth. So let's remove the filter other than Scripture from how we see these things, and then let's apply a filter for when we are communicating of tenderness and grace. Please bow with me. Lord, I'm grateful that we can talk about some of these things, and I'm grateful that you've addressed how you want us to live in a hostile environment in your word. And Lord, my prayer is that as we spend time together over the next few weeks, you'd open our eyes to your truth, that if our thinking is off, you'd correct it. If our hearts are hard, that you'd soften them. For those of us who tend to be bold, tenderize us. For those of us who tend to be tender, embolden us. Oh, Jesus, be tender and bold through us. We know you are with us. We know you are in us. We want people to see you in us. So as Scott sings this prayer, we continue in the spirit of prayer, asking you to do this in us.